So as you can see, the CAPS pandemic was catastrophic. And as we've said, the impact of a severe pandemic is not only a result of the disease itself, but really the cascading economic and societal consequences that would follow. Now, we don't want to give you the impression that traditional public health measures aren't valuable, because they absolutely are. In fact, in the 200-some outbreaks that WHO responds to each year, interventions such as isolation of the sick, social distancing, disease surveillance, really do help to interrupt the spread of disease and control epidemics before they become pandemics. But in a severe, fast-moving pandemic, it may not be possible to contain the spread through these kinds of traditional measures. And as we saw in the scenario, there's a limit to what government, NGOs, and global business can do on the fly to stop a widespread and lethal pandemic. That's why prior planning and promotion of routine public-private cooperation in advance of the next pandemic is really critical. So we dealt with four serious international policy challenges today, but in an actual pandemic, there would be many more. In the exercise, the board wrestled with a series of very difficult problems, and you did a terrific job with no ability to prepare and a really fast-paced and complex set of issues. But assuming we do have a few years to prepare, what should we do to prevent this from becoming a reality? In advance of the exercise today, we drafted a list of actions that we think would start to move us in the right direction. And now that you participated in the exercise, we really want to seek your input on other things we could do to be better prepared. Our initial suggestions are these. First, global business should recognize the economic burden of pandemics and really fight for stronger preparedness. Business leaders and their shareholders could actively engage with governments and advocate for increased resources for pandemic preparedness. Second, governments and businesses should plan now for how corporate capabilities could be used for a large-scale pandemic. Industry assets, if swiftly and appropriately deployed, really could help to save lives and reduce economic losses. So governments could work now to identify the most critical areas of need and reach out to industry players with the goal of finalizing agreements in advance of a large pandemic. Third, we think industry and national governments should work with WHO to enhance internationally held stockpiles of MCMs and personal protective equipment so that it could be equitably distributed during a large pandemic. The WHO's existing influenza vaccine virtual stockpile is a good model that could be expanded and augment WHO's ability to distribute vaccines, therapeutics, diagnostics, other PPE to countries in the greatest need. Countries that would have to support this effort through the provision of additional funding to WHO. Fourth, countries and global transportation companies, we believe, should work together to maintain travel and trade during a severe pandemic. I think you all agreed that travel and trade are essential to the global economy as well as to national and local economies, and they need to be maintained. But public-private cooperation is necessary in order to explore potential solutions to that really difficult problem. Fifth, governments should provide more resources and support for the development of surge manufacturing of vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics. Countries may need population-level supplies of safe and effective MCMs in a pandemic. So we're therefore really going to have the need to rapidly develop, manufacture, distribute, and dispense large quantities of MCMs. Countries with enough resources should make this more of a priority than they do today. Sixth, we should increase and reassess pandemic financial support. The World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, regional development banks, national governments, and foundations should explore ways to increase the availability of funds in a pandemic and ensure that they could be flexibly used when they're needed. And finally, governments in the private sector should assign a greater priority to developing methods to combat mis- and disinformation related to pandemic response. Governments will need to partner with traditional and social media in order to research and develop nimble approaches to countering misinformation. For their part, media companies, we believe, should commit to ensuring that authoritative messages are prioritized and really false messages are suppressed. So those were our initial thoughts, and we'd love your ideas of what else should be on this list. So we have asked Jean Meserve, formerly of CNN and ABC News, who anchored that final epilogue video, to moderate a discussion now and solicit your ideas. Jean?
So first I want to ask you for your reactions to these proposals that have been put on the table, and also ask you, do you have some additional action steps that you think could and perhaps should be taken? Yes, please go ahead.
I agree with all of these, but I think there are other things that can and should be done. If Mike Ryan were here, the gentleman we saw at the outset, he would tell us that the mechanisms to actually do the prevention work, that's very hard to actually get enough funding for that around the world. And if I similarly look, so I chair a body called CEPI, the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations. We are investing in the development of vaccines in the neglected space. For example, MERS vaccines of this kind, the coronavirus. We do not invest enough as a globe in even having the basic options that we could scale up for manufacture. And that's both in the vaccine space, but also in also diagnostics, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So I do think putting on this list the financing of both preparedness in a number of countries, but also the technology preparedness, particularly in the vaccines, et cetera, would be a welcome addition to the list.
Any thoughts from among you on how to increase that funding? Yes.
Yeah, can I support Jane so and by say something about what I said about science-based, you know, information earlier? Obviously, we are living in the 21st century, so we need to build up the capacity and the facilities to make sure, you know, for example, today the event we discussed about 2 months, the epidemic already 2 months. Say we have a half year epidemic. I think about Zima played during 2014 Ebola outbreak in West Africa. Though what we are talking about is CAPS, it's a new virus, and all the vaccine, all the available antibiotics wouldn't work. But give you half a year or 2 months, we are ready. If you have the capacity at the facility, we are ready to produce from the survivor for some monoclonal antibodies. While you have ZMAP-like antibodies or antivirals, I think you will restore the confidence of the public. So this is our step. We put that one to say, unite together under the WHO, put for some pharmaceutical companies to have the capacity or, you know, facility to get prepared for monoclonal antibody producing.
Go ahead, Tim.
So first of all, I think we should, in the spirit of accountability, assess the effectiveness of this board. And, and as an optimist, I'd like to say that we take full responsibility for this not reaching 100 million deaths or 200 million deaths. It was only 65 million, so there was some effectiveness of the board. But I think the question more seriously is what sort of coordination do we have? And I didn't see, I saw collaboration and things that should be done, but I think when the rubber hits the road, if we don't have well-established standalone coordination mechanisms that bring the right players together to make decisions on how best to respond across a sector, then we will not achieve the collective efficiency that I think many of us would hope that a simulation exercise would.
So any ideas on how to do that? How do we centralize that information in order to get situational awareness, set the priorities, establish the communications protocols?
So I would just say I'm missing here, and it may be that, you know, you don't want to recommend what you're doing, but I think we need a series of simulations which get us much more refined in terms of working with the different dimensions of the response that have to be mobilized in a fast-moving pandemic, and then develop a set of standard operating procedures that could be agreed around with designated leadership, which could then be drawn upon should we reach or enter into a fast-moving pandemic. So more of this.
So just to agree with, these recommended actions and with Tim that we should do more simulations, I think particularly doing them in places where decisions will get made locally, at local public health authorities. I think particularly in urban areas, as we saw in this, it spread quickly in megacities first. And I think in as it spread to other regions, some of the regional economic communities in Eastern, Southern Africa, West Africa, I think those simulations will be important with the people who will actually be making those decisions. But I wanted to build on Jane's comment about the research and development enterprise, because I think it highlights another gap. I do think we need to put more financing into things like the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation to prepare as their strategy is for things we can predict, MERS, other Ebola, other things that we know are coming, Nipah. But I think, like we saw in this scenario, there will be emergence of pathogens we can't predict. So
disease
we have to really
X.
work at you know, disease X,
disease.
The, or CAPS. You know, platforms that can be rapidly mobilized using reverse vaccinology. I think we have to go beyond vaccines to other countermeasures, diagnostics, et cetera. And there, one of the stumbling blocks has been, and I think George was getting at this, the rapid sharing of information, particularly gene sequencing information. Often countries are reluctant to share samples or sequence information because they're concerned about the distributive justice. If we contribute to the science, will we benefit from the science? And I think, as Mike referred to in the opening video, we have a partial solution for that in the pandemic influenza area through the PIP. But we need to expand that to other potential pathogens so that in the event of a fast-moving pandemic, countries don't hesitate to share the information that will be vital for science to do its job and develop countermeasures. And they won't hesitate because they'll know they'll also benefit. And that regime doesn't exist yet. And whether we approach it through the World Health Assembly, build on the international health regulations, we need to have that in place ahead of time. Because establishing that kind of trust in the face of a fast-moving pandemic is even harder to do.
And just to add to that, to be completely clear, it took us years to negotiate the PIP framework. I actually chaired the Intergovernmental Working Relationship meeting that did that. And that was when one country lost confidence in the global virus sharing mechanism, chose not to share, and it took us years to rebuild that trust and that confidence. And I would argue it's not completely there yet.
Just like to observe that there's a convergence of the two ideas that we've just heard. I think if there is confidence among countries that the governance and the sharing exists and that it can be relied upon, there'll be a greater willingness to share samples and information. Mm-hmm. So I think those two things really fit together.
And we have to keep the awareness alive, and it's our responsibility to do this and to do simulations, to do actions, to recommend actions like this. But I know exactly what happens when I go home to Zurich and when I talk about this next week in my company. They will tell me, yes, we know, but there are all the daily businesses to do. And I think we have to keep this alive. We all know that there is Ebola right now, and we all know that there is a risk that it spreads out. We all know that there will be a next virus. But let's face it, we have to keep the awareness up. We have to talk about it. We have to get ready in due time. We have to set up platforms to exchange our information in due time. And that's the way how we can convince the companies, the leaders, and the organizations about this need.
Yeah, just an observation. I mean, all of us here are from large companies, but you know, in an increasingly globalized world, how do we bring the small and medium-sized enterprises along with us? And I think maybe we didn't speak about that enough today. So, I mean, you are only as strong as your weakest link. And so, you know, some of these things that we talked about, like business continuity plans, how do you build capacity in small and medium-sized enterprises that they need to have some of these plans? And I think, you know, to your question, financing is definitely going to be an issue, right? Because you need to set aside resources. And this is where I think something we spoke about might come to play. It's probably a PPP type framework where the government works with the industry associations and the companies to set aside some fundings to make sure that everyone has some of these basic plans in place.
Yeah, I'd like to follow on from that. I mean, I think there are a number of good examples of collaborative sort of forums like the WEF, like the Private Sector Roundtable for GHSA and so on. But, you know, there's this notion that the private sector should get behind something and develop solutions for things that aren't here in the absence of real committed resources, number one, from the public sector or others. And number two, without really having any form of formal decision-making contribution. And I think that's an important one because, for example, you know, we may be a large company, so we're working on Ebola, working on the HIV vaccine, you know, working on tuberculosis, we're doing stuff in Zika and dengue fever, but there's a limit. And that's an opportunity cost that in non-commercial applications, humanitarian, sure, economically important, sure, there's a huge opportunity cost of pursuing that that many other companies can't take. And yet if you look at the interaction scientifically with organizations like the UN, WHO, then it's like, you know, non-state actors, stay out. And so if you're asking the private sector to get together to commit, which I think they would, by the way, then, you know, the value of that investment and the likelihood that it's going to end up anywhere meaningful has to be addressed at some level. Otherwise, why would we take the opportunity cost?
Any idea how to do that?
Yeah, establish a true cross-sectoral body that actually develops guidelines, thinks about mechanisms, talks about these broader issues together, and actually allow not single companies, but industry bodies to have some kind of input and voting rights into that. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's like the common good theory, and it's all very well, but we all have to go back to our companies on Monday.
Mm-hmm. Tim, go ahead.
Yeah, I want to build on this because what I worry about is that these last two comments, which is everybody gets excited around a table like this in the moment, and then you move on, and it's back to business as usual. And it's this panicked and neglect problem that we have, which is very difficult to prospectively develop real preparedness. So I think there should be somewhere, maybe it's out of the GPMB, and a number of people here are the Global Preparedness Monitoring Board, there should be a time-bound plan with very clear targets with respect to what would constitute a new level of global preparedness. And we should look at what's required to get that financed in such a way that it's not purely, you know, the goodwill of everybody coming together occasionally because they're at Davos or they're in New York, but that it has some real accountability to agents that lie behind or are advocating for a stronger global governance, but a practical one. It's not that WHO will do everything. It's that the various constituencies that have to be mobilized have identified what I would call SOPs on how to move forward in discrete areas that we know are going to be critical in moving this agenda so that we're not in the next outbreak saying, geez, we should have done this, and only if we'd done that. Well, let's do more learning, you know, after learning reviews.
A little late at that point, Matt Harrington.
So I share the concern about how to maintain sustained interest, let alone a sense of urgency around what would appear to be an inevitable. And the thought, one thought I have is, you know, to the point of, do we create a moment in time that we work toward? And the analogy or analog to that would, for me, be Y2K. Public-private sector understood that there was a definitive moment at midnight in 2000 that people had to address a situation and prepare accordingly. And even if it didn't redound to the individual in many instances, it laddered up to larger organizations. And I think, again, to a point I made earlier about the absence of technology at this table, the lessons learned from how that sector advanced both awareness and remediation is something that could be brought to this conversation.
Can I just make one comment about Y2K? When I was trying to advocate inside government in relation to the potential threat from H5N1 that was endemic in Indonesia, I was actually told by an extremely senior person who I will not name that actually I was basically just on about Y2K with feathers. Okay. So could I just advocate for finding some other point in time reference, which I had to come up with in that circumstance. So I just share that.
Yeah.
No. One of the threads that I pulled from the conversation around the table today was the lack of data, that you don't have enough data to really have situational awareness when an outbreak begins, that you don't know where the resources are, you don't know how to move them and where to move them. In this world, where there is an abundance of data, is there a way to better coordinate between the public and private sectors in order to capitalize on that data, to learn more and learn it faster and move faster?
I think you've hit on a couple of points that are really important. In an event like this, moving or having a scale of operation larger than we've done for a health event is going to be very important. So it's really outside of the bounds of experience. The other element is to be able to move quickly and at a speed necessary. I think that the opportunity to develop those kinds of mechanisms would be the kind of governance system that we're talking about, that could be part of the agenda for a preparedness activity at a governmental scale. The other thing I would just comment is that an event like this is going to be outside of the health sphere, and so it'll be really important that this not be seen as a health event, but really as a global crisis, and that those parts of government outside of health that are going to be in the lead are leading in this preparedness work as well.
Any other thoughts on the data piece? Go
ahead. I think the data is critical, but I'll use that to segue to another area, if I may, which is the human resource. And a key actor, given that I now have moved to academia, but it is the academic or the training sector. Because if we're really going to develop a surge capacity for something like this, where you're going to have to bring in the reserves, the global health reserves in some respect, it requires an incredible coordination across training institutions, both in terms of pre-service and deployment, how people keep up skills that would be relevant. And that plan won't emerge from global businesses and governments collaborating. It's really got to bring in the higher education sector much more fundamentally, and I would argue with national public health institutes.
I wanted to follow up on the trusted voice idea.
Yeah.
I think everyone around the table spoke about how important it is to find those voices. Do we need to find them now and establish trust in those voices now so that when the crisis hits, people already have the established trust? Thoughts?
I mean, I would say without question, and because you're in a better position to build up that bank of goodwill in advance of a crisis. And I'm very intrigued and I think very heartened by the conversation about the identification of community and faith-based leaders in particular, because they do foster enormous trust at a local level. And that.
But there are people who, at this point, probably know very little about pandemic preparedness.
And hence education is necessary.
In advance?
Yes.
I think newsrooms in particular, there's a reason why they have people on the staff, actual former physicians and things, that are constantly talking about different diseases or illnesses that are coming up so that they continue to build that trust so that when there is a situation like this, there is already somebody on staff from the medical professional that's a trusted voice, whether it's on any of the networks, that's able to speak up.
Actually, you made a point earlier about the anti-vaccine movement that's going forward right now. And there was going to be a community event tomorrow in New York City that actually ended up being canceled yesterday because it was only anti-vaccine advocates as a part of a community event. And nobody from the professional medical community would join even in the conversation. So the organizers ultimately, because they were a bit shamed into that imbalance, canceled the event. But it does call out that that's a real issue at the moment that needs to be addressed and should probably serve as a beta, if you will, for this kind of a moment.
Sorry. On this issue of trust, I think there's something that's specific with respect to pandemics, but I think if we look at DRC at the moment, the distrust relates to the health system more generally. We didn't detect the first case in this 10th outbreak for 3 months because health workers were on strike because they weren't being paid. And so I think this community needs to pay particular attention to health systems that have very low levels of public trust, because they then, if you don't have that as a foundation, mm-hmm. you're not going to gain it in the context, or it's very difficult to gain in the context of an outbreak.
Mm. Go ahead. Yeah.
In similar lines, maybe, but in the spirit of kind of learning from history, in 1918, 16 million people died. That was more than the two great wars. And one of the impending results was a massive shortage of physicians, care providers. So I don't see that on the list. I don't have any solution. If you ask me what we do about it, that would be a subcommittee of this wonderful committee, which I'm only a guest of, so I'm not taking credit for it. But the shortage of physicians is looming anyway in the United States. I don't know about the broader world, but that's something should be considered in this. And second point I would only make is that if it really were catastrophic, I don't know if we're prepared for the civil unrest that could result in it. And we haven't really talked much about our public safety vehicles, not just public safety avenues ready, including military. Are they ready for such civil unrest if it were really to get out of hand? I don't see those in the recommended actions. That's all.
I'd love to get down to the surprises and the big takeaways. And I'd love to, if you guys are willing, to do a round the table thing and get everybody's input on what they learned here and if anything shocked them. Avril, can we start with you?
Sure, Ivan. I should take a few minutes to think about that. I do think that, generally, and this comes out of our conversation that we've just been having, the areas that it seems to me require enlightened leadership, in a sense, is the issue of funding, right? And actually attracting greater funding to this issue. We all know that by spending money on preparedness now, we can save money later. And the fact that we don't have the mechanisms in place that allow us to more effectively address a crisis in the moment is critically attached to that. It does seem to me another piece of this is the, from my perspective, you know, it's not a surprise, but it's certainly a takeaway from the discussion, is the need for greater communication mechanisms between the private sector and the public sector and the healthcare sector in actually trying to manage a situation and to best leverage each other's essentially resources under the circumstances. And I think that's a critical aspect of what has to happen, and one that, frankly, the current system isn't well positioned to do, because we frequently work through the public sector and we have a variety of challenges in creating those sort of private sector and other industry connections to what we're doing. Another piece of it that really didn't come up in the discussion, but from my perspective is another aspect of it, and there's far more experience and knowledge about health, public health issues in this room than I have, but it's, but those frontline health workers, I mean, the World Health Organization has talked about the enormous shortfall and that fact that they are utterly critical to identifying, detecting, and allowing for a response very quickly. And that's, you know, sort of at the key, if we can do that quickly, then we can get to a possible answer, a vaccine, other countermeasures that need to be brought in more quickly. And so that's fundamental. And if we're able to establish communication networks that, you know, as Tim mentioned, go both ways to allow us to both take advantage of the opportunity to communicate outwards, but also to take advantage of the opportunity to hear from those frontline healthcare workers, we're gonna be more effective. But we do need to train them so that they're actually capable of identifying the symptoms and issues that we should be responding to and developing those triggers. And I think that larger piece is the, you know, sort of the most important part of it, is if you can actually create the preparedness systems, then you actually have a plan that triggers the investment that you need at the time that you need it and the communication that you need.
Time is going short.
Sorry. Quickly.
Okay. In addition to this table discussion, I've been in many, many prepared meetings already, response or whatever meeting. So I would follow Adrian's comments. you know, financially or, you know, whatsoever, cross-sectoral coordination. I already mentioned from the very beginning. So we have meetings and discussions, but how would we, either private or governmental or, you know, political or diplomatic or whatsoever, including data sharing, how would we have a kind of a coordinated effort and cross-sectoral coordinated efforts? We still haven't got an answer for that. So that's the key.
Okay, and there are a lot of barriers. Jane.
It takes a lot to shock me, so I can't say anything shocked me. I think what this has reinforced, though, to me, is there is an absence of a centre to convene what is something that is broader than just a health issue. It's reinforced for me the fatigue problem. The truth is, more people did die in the 1918 pandemic than died in World War I and World War II combined, and yet we talk about that all the time and we don't talk about the pandemic. 25% of people in Samoa died because people were allowed off a ship. So those impacts are not talked about anymore. And then I guess the other thing that it's reinforced to me is how much more work there is to do on this issue, particularly from, if I can describe it in this way, a more ecosystem perspective. So it's not just from the health perspective, it's not just from the perspective of private injury, it's not just perspective of government, it's from the entire ecosystem.
I think this is a really technical argument, and it's a bit like, honestly, it's a bit like when's the next asteroid going to hit us? And I think people get lost in that. And if you want to take this into something that's really actionable, you have to get down to, you know, the consumer level, the person who doesn't live in West Africa waiting for Ebola, but the person who actually, like I do, lives in New Hope, Pennsylvania, and doesn't see it. Until you get to that level, then you're not going to get the traction and the actionability behind it. Like, what would I do different on Monday? You know, it's kind of a question for people not living right now in West Africa. So I think, for me, the big aha about this is, it's not bad, but it's a technical discussion with technical people who are involved in this every day and to the exclusion of the community, I'd say.
I'm struck by how probably this is, the broader public is unaware of just how severe this could be. That strikes me, and I would share that I think an increase of knowledge on that, which could hopefully lead to more prevention and wellness in our healthcare system rather than the acuity that we deal with, at least in the United States. More focus on prevention and wellness and specifically primary care, oral care, which has a direct correlation with, you know, overall health, and that helps immunity system. So I'm really struck by that mostly.
I think it's very important to not be shocked. I think when we're shocked, we're not able to make decisions to do the right thing. And I think some of what we've done today is just help us think through what a really bad scenario might look like. Before an event like this, having the systems in place to coordinate more effectively is essential. In the long term, biotechnology, and as Chris said, the ability to rapidly develop a specific countermeasure is important. The requirements there are incredibly difficult. Within weeks, have something that everybody could take. I'd say in the response, it will be really important to think about what the aim of the response is and how much can actually be accomplished. I actually think in this event, given what we heard up through the first moves, the outcome was really not as bad as it might have been. And I think we need to, as we're responding to this, we need to be clear about what is achievable with the interventions that we have and not overestimate the impact we can have.
Chris?
I guess my surprise, not shock, but surprise, is the presumption of competence of the system. One of the things that struck me in the earliest video was that the poll showed that 2/3, I think it was, of the population thought a vaccine would be available in 2 months. This is a population that is, at least in my state, a significant minority of people willing to question whether they should give the kids the vaccines we have today that have been around for decades, proven to be safe and effective. And yet, in the face of a crisis, 2/3 of them presume that the scientific community will come up with a vaccine within 2 months. That's dangerous, magical thinking. And we have to, you know, get a better set of messages out about what what the threat is and what could be happening. I think there's an implicit presumed competence of governments and the UN system that's probably greater than it should be as well. I think governments being clear about what they can do and what they cannot do in the face of an epidemic will help increase individual and community preparedness.
Yeah, don't overpromise. Sophia?
Thank you. I mean, for me, this really exposed the vulnerabilities, not around the room, but in terms of the country comparisons. And those vulnerabilities already exist in the poorer countries. And so how are we going to strengthen those capabilities, whether through the health sector or governments? And that these solutions that we've been talking, the discussion for me has been sectoral, and we need to figure out a way. I'm not saying that United Nations has the answer to all of this, but we need to figure out a way that can bring all stakeholders to the table in a situation like this to be able to bring the best solutions to
private sector as well as government too.
Yeah.
Tim?
Great. Well, I'm convinced increasingly that simulations are stimulating. And I think they have a real value. And so I want to make sure that that gets added to the list of recommended actions. I think we have to look and complement that stimulation with a much clearer commitment to driving change in behavior in a very complex system in specific areas. And I think this is helpful, but if we lay this on the four reports that were produced following the West Africa crisis, if we link it into the ongoing activities of the Global Preparedness Monitoring Board, I think we would come up with an ambitious agenda, but one that gets sufficiently refined that we can begin to hold ourselves accountable to that.
Okay. This side of the table, I'm going to have to ask you to be very brief, but Latoya, go for it.
Yes. To take a look at the takeaways from our history, and we speak of the 1918 flu epidemic and Ebola, basically look at all of the actions that were taken there, bring those together, prepare a regulatory or a protocol that you can start to work on, and try to increase communication from government to government, so we'll be able to share healthcare information, whether it's genome therapy, whatever's taking place to try to combat the disease or virus.
Okay.
Great. Appreciate the focus on preparedness. As we look at communities that are, let's say, vulnerable to natural disasters or crisis, I mean, we look at trying to foster that community hub, bringing together faith-based organizations, academia, government, small businesses all together. On the other end of the spectrum, we believe that the World Economic Forum is a great platform that brought together post-Ebola a great group of the WHO, the World Food Program, led by Henry Schein, J&J, and we are all loosely together because, again, sustainability, keeping the interest of these institutions is always the challenge.
Yeah.
I think, first of all, in major global corporations, you know, when you think about even the regulations there are for how many executives can get on one plane at a time, there are all these succession plans already in place. So what are the plans that the global organizations are having in place in case of such a situation like this? And then I think the thing I'm surprised about, we didn't bring this into this at all, but politics. If this is taking place from October to December 18th, 2019, with the debates going on and the presidential election coming up in about a year, I think that would play a major part in this kind of scenario.
Interesting mm-hmm. point. Martin, quickly.
3 points. Use the time that you actually have for preparation in the best way. Set up and maintain information exchange platforms and keep the awareness. It's our responsibility to do this. Thank you.
Excellent.
For me, my learning was the risk of misinformation and disinformation. I think it requires a lot more thought and coordination across the stakeholders.
And one point, despite the alignment around the room about the importance of some central leadership, I think the challenge in agreeing on the central leadership. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you all. I think summing this up as I see it, investment, planning, preparation, coordinating, prioritization, and obviously all the advanced thought and effort given to those things will hopefully mitigate the effects when the pandemic comes. Thank you all very much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Jean, and thanks to all of our players for these excellent suggestions. Our plan now is to consider your ideas, the results of today, and come forward with a set of recommendations and a call to action. And we hope that with your experience today, you will continue to be amazing champions for this issue. It's extremely valuable, but very rare, for a group of this diversity to come and spend part of the day talking about these issues. So on behalf of our partners at the World Economic Forum and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, I want to thank our players again for their participation and insights today. You did an amazing job in a really difficult scenario. And I also like to thank our broader audience here in New York, as well as those participating online. And of course, our amazing center faculty and staff, and the larger Event 201 team from the Gates Foundation and the World Economic Forum for putting together today's events. So please join us down the hall in the Cotillion Room for the luncheon, and we stand adjourned. Thank you.